Okay, I got a bone to pick with some of you guys out there. You've said, hey, this bike is so boring. It's the most boring bike Honda's made in a long time. It's so vanilla. I'm going to use these videos to put myself to sleep at night. Power! Lies. Lies. This motorcycle is not boring. Ow, huh? Design for an adventure bike that this sticks down. Imagine how much more ground clearance we'd have if this wasn't here. We should probably even it out, huh? Ah. Oh shit. ABS. Gosh darn it. Ah. Shit. I have another bone to pick with you guys. A lot of you have said, oh, this bike's not going to be ever as good as a T7 off-road. I don't agree with that at all. I think that's complete hogwash. The only thing is, hello everyone, my name is Ian and you're watching Big Rock Moto. Thank you so much for tuning in today, and if you're new here and you like this kind of content, I hope you'll consider subscribing. Episode 2 of the Transalp 750 long-term ownership review series. We are going to do the first ride video today on the Transalp. Got my cameras ready, got my helmet ready, got everything ready to go. Just make a couple tweaks here on the bike before we get started. So let me show you what I'm going to do. Our motorcycle is completely bone stock, all right? No modifications. That's the point of this episode, is to test the bike with the stock Karoo tires, stock equipment, no changes. The only little thing I'm going to do is adjust the suspension for my weight. So I'm around 200 pounds, around 90 kilograms. I also did the tire pressures. So the manual gives you a couple different options. They say up to 200 pounds, you could do 36 PSI rear, 33 in the front. So that's what I've got it set to. Over 200 pounds, they want you to go up to 42 PSI in the back. So we're gonna use the lower setting because we are gonna be doing a little bit of dirt roads today as well. The other thing I'm gonna do is Honda has given us adjustable preload for the front and rear suspension. Now, one issue I have with some other reviews I've read out there or watched on YouTube is that they said, oh, you can make the suspension firmer or softer. That is not true. The preload does not make the suspension softer or firmer. We need to get our heads around this, okay? It's a real pet peeve of mine. So what the preload does is it changes the ride height or the sag of the motorcycle. So the sag is how much does the suspension compress into the stroke when you sit on the bike, okay? That does not make the suspension harder or firmer. Okay, that's something we need to be very clear about. The purpose of the preload is to adjust for riders of different weight to correct the suspension geometry for changes in weight and changes in load. So that's what I'm going to do right now. So in the manual here, it says that the spring preload on the forks has 15 turns, and the standard position is 7 turns from full soft. So what I'm going to do here with my 19 millimeter wrench is I'm just going to go ahead and give this maybe 3 more turns, considering I'm probably a little bit heavier than Honda designed the bike for. So we'll do half turn at a time. Half, one, half, two, half, three. Okay, so one half, two and a half, three. Okay, so we've got 3 turns there. Now, in order to do the rear, we have to pull the toolkit out. So to take the seat off, there's a key right here, really easy spot that they put the key. I like that. Seat comes off super easily. Typical Honda. So under the seat, we've got the battery. Concerningly, we don't have the airbox. We're going to cover that in episode 3 with the full technical breakdown. Airbox is actually up here, and yeah, that's a story for another day, but it's not good. Okay, so let's take the toolkit out, and in here is a little spanner that we can use to adjust the rear preload. This is going to be hard to see, but inside here, yeah, you can't really see it. Let's try to stick the camera in there. Yeah, down in there is the collar for the spring preload. So I'm going to go ahead and give this, set this towards the higher end just to compensate for my weight, and then we'll get riding. All right, so in today's ride, I am wearing the MSR Adventure Boots, the Climb K52 Kevlar Reinforced Riding Jean, Alpinstar Halo Gloves, Alpinstar Halo Jacket, super versatile, lots of venting options, take the sleeves off. the Kraos Pro helmet and my foamers glasses, which kind of act like goggles. So let's get going on the ride. Firing up the Transalp, the TFT is on the small side. My phone is bigger than this TFT. However, it's crisp, it's sharp, and there's a lot of different display options that you can set up. I like this display here. It looks kind of cool. And then you've got riding mode, you've got a clock, you've got the fuel gauge. We're going to go get gas. You've got a bunch of information here on the bottom, which you can scroll through, which is cool. The bike there, you can see 1 mile on the bike, so that's nice. Trip A, trip B, yeah. We've got a quick shifter indicator. We've got power mode. Power does not change the horsepower of the bike. Let's get that clear. It changes the throttle response only. You have the same horsepower no matter what power mode you have. That's a common misconception about how ride modes work. On some motorcycles, ride modes do change the power. On this motorcycle, it does not. Engine braking, traction control, ABS setting. All right, mirrors look good. Everything feels good. It feels typical Honda. Like, everything feels super high quality, and the controls are much more simple to use than, like, the Africa Twin or the Goldwing. But that makes sense because the bike has less features. You know, the engine has a nice sound to it. For a parallel twin, it actually, I think it sounds pretty good. So first thing we're going to do is, well, let me give you some kind of early impressions, how I feel about the motorcycle in terms of the weight and everything like that. I can flat foot on both sides. The motorcycle, the seat height is around, I think, 820. I'll put that in a text here below. Does it feel top heavy? I mean, not really. No, like I can lean the motorcycle like all the way like this and lift it up. It doesn't feel heavy. So right away, I'm feeling really positive vibes about that as compared to something like the V-strom 800, which is kind of top heavy, or even the Tenere 700, which is kind of top heavy. I also like how Honda has given us a readout of the actual engine coolant temperature at the top instead of like a gauge. It shows me the actual temperature. Boy, this bike is, it feels compact and light. It definitely feels way, way smaller than something like, you know, an Africa Twin. All right, let's go. Oh, I started out in second gear there. I don't know why I did that. It doesn't... And you know, it's funny, it doesn't feel super torquey, right? It definitely feels like this engine is going to want some more RPMs. But so far, it feels pretty smooth. And I'm pretty impressed with the wind protection. I'm going 62 miles an hour. I'm going 100 kilometers an hour. And there's a little bit of wind buffeting on the peak of my helmet. I can feel it kind of fluttering. But if I duck down like 2 inches, I'm in super quiet, stable pocket of air. So I think that a slightly taller screen, or maybe fitting my little deflector, my little clip-on visor, is going to cure that. And that would be awesome, because one of the biggest things for me on a motorcycle is I want to be comfortable. I don't want to feel like my head is in a blender getting shaken around like I do on my KTM 890, which is just horrible for that. So I already really appreciate that very much. So we're at 4,000 RPM at 65 miles an hour, about 105 kilometers an hour. We'll take this thing on the freeway and really see how it is. So I'm in a standard mode. Yeah, roll-on power doesn't have a lot of roll-on power in sixth gear, but we're gonna get this thing. We're gonna really test this thing. Don't worry about it. We're gonna get the revs really up there. Let's use the quick shifter. Okay, all right. All right, it has some induction sound from the airbox. The airbox is here, like it is on the Aprilia Touareg, and so maybe that's contributing, but you can hear the snorkels, the air going through the air snorkels. I'll do that again. Oh, that's fantastic. That's really good. I'm really impressed also that I don't really feel any vibrations from the engine. Now, I have the rubber inserts in the foot peg still, and everything is stock, so we take those out for the off-road, but the handlebars feel very smooth. So my first impression of the bike is super positive. Comfort is so important for me, like butter. Okay. Like, it's not fast, but the bike has good pull, you know, that is good pull. And let's go into, just for fun here, let's go into sport mode and see. Wow, I like this engine a lot. It has that nice induction sound. Yeah, it's good. I do miss the extra, I want that extra 7 horsepower that they get in Europe, that 90 horsepower, because we only get 83 horsepower, so that kind of stinks, but. Ooh, okay, I gotta make sure. Okay, I'm breaking in my tires. Come on, let's not be MotoGP here. Ooh, this thing, she handles, man. It doesn't steer very fast. Like, it has slow steering, which I think is actually a good thing. I'll talk about that in a second. Let's really give this thing some revs here. Okay. Okay, you know what? Yeah, this engine loves to rev. It really does. For the handling, it's super confidence inspiring. I mean, you know, these bikes with these 21-inch front wheels, they've gotten so much better over the years. I can really hustle this thing. Brakes feel, you know, nice. They feel nice. The rear suspension, man, I don't know. I know people said I was going to complain about this, and they're saying, oh, he's going to bag on the suspension. I already am, though. Like, the rear shock feels really bouncy to me. Like, it feels like it's got, like, just not enough rebound, even just on the highway. But that being said, I can still hustle this bike, and this thing is really fun. Yeah. Woo! I like this engine. It would be nice with 7 more horsepower, though. That's how you break in an engine right there. The fork dive is not too bad. You know, it's a long travel suspension. It's 200 millimeters, so you are going to have fork dive. The ride is smooth, but yeah, it definitely feels bouncy in the back, you know. The sign of a budget suspension, for sure. So the suspension rake angle, you know, it's going to pay dividends in the dirt, I think, because a 27 degree, or maybe 27 and a half degree, I can't remember, suspension rake, that's a very stable number. So a longer rake, when it's like, you know, more raked out, is going to be more stable. It slows down the steering, but it's more predictable handling, especially if you hit sand, a deep gravel, stuff like that. On the road, it doesn't feel quite as sharp to turn in, but it holds the line really well, and it's stable. And I think at high speed, you know, for touring and stuff, that's going to pay dividends there as well.
All right, well, I'm really genuinely enjoying this first ride so far on the Transalp here behind me, but I don't know if it's just me. Let me know what you guys think, but I kind of feel like the Transalp has a little bit of an identity crisis. It doesn't know what it wants to be. Let me flip this around and kind of tell you kind of where I'm coming from. So if we look at the Transalp and some of the design elements of it, okay, so to me, I see spoke wheels, I see a 21-inch front wheel, and I see tube-type tires. Now, all of those things to me say dirt bike. Off-road bike, right? That's the things that dirt bikes have. But then I look at this down here, right? Okay, so they routed the exhaust, and I know this is, they're using the engine, you know, from the Hornet. They have to use it for multiple models. I get that. But I mean, look at this. And then you've got this sump here that sticks down where the oil drains out, and that's going to catch, like, so the skid plate is mandatory. I don't get that design. Plus, I also, like, okay, so the low exhaust, the good thing is it makes room for luggage up here, okay? And it keeps the exhaust away from your passengers' hands and stuff. But this is pretty vulnerable, like off-road. So again, and then we come to the electronics, all right? And this is not a complaint, okay? I don't mean to rant, but it doesn't hold your settings for traction control and ABS. So why would you do that? Like, again, are you trying to be a touring bike? Are you trying to be an off-road bike? I don't really get it. Like, it's lightweight, it handles really easy. I mean, riding around here in the dirt, it feels super easy to ride and nimble. But again, I just feel like, you know, what is it trying to be? A little bit of an identity crisis in terms of the Transalp, but I still love the bike.
All right, let's get some fuel here. Normal fuel opener like that, that's no problem. Only the finest. Boy, these gas prices are getting out of hand here. $6.49 for premium.
Of course, I am in Idlewild, which is a small town, and the gas is very expensive. Let's see. I was down 2 bars. I don't know how much, but that's the point of filling it up. I want to start with the full tank and then kind of start checking our range here. I got 50 miles a gallon according to the screen on just coming up here, and that was coming up the mountain. So I think this bike's going to get really good fuel economy. Now, speaking of fuel, one thing I want to mention is that, you know, one of my complaints always about the Tenere 700 that I owned was it was a 4.2 gallon fuel tank. This is 4.6. It's a half gallon bigger, and you get a real world, I think, about 200 mile range out of this, which is better than about 160, 170 you got on the T7. So that's good. I would like to see a 5 gallon tank or a 20 liter tank, but you know, again, they're trying to keep the bike somewhat lightweight and trim. So I guess I can live with 4.6 gallons. So an observation I have already is that I've been spending a lot of time like this riding with my visor up. And that's a sign of the wind protection on here is very good. Looking at the fairing and the windshield, I wasn't expecting it to be such a smooth ride in terms of the lack of turbulence, the lack of buffeting. All I really need is maybe a couple inches more on the height. Maybe a tiny bit wider would be good. And man, this thing is going to be so dialed for touring. I just love that so much, because being able to get fresh air and ride with my visor open like this, man, I could never do this on like my 890 Adventure. It just has such horrible aerodynamics. This is something I really appreciate about this bike already very much. And overall, just the overall feeling of comfort in the bike, you know, you do feel like you sit down inside of it more than something like a T7 or maybe even a v-strom 800. I like this LCD. I like the seat. The seat feels nice and cushy. I can already tell you, this is already a much nicer like street bike than the T7 is. Compared to the V-Strom 800, I don't know. That bike is pretty good at everything. It's hard to say. This has more of a windshield for sure. The engine feels kind of similar to the V-Strom to me, actually. That I really appreciate, which I did not expect at this price point, it has self-canceling turn signals. Look at that. That's awesome. What a great job, Honda. Self-canceling signals on a $10,000 bike. That's set a good example for everybody else. I like that. Now let's put on my emergency flashers here, which I like having that feature, because I want to talk a little bit about the engine heat. So it's about 93 degree Fahrenheit. Okay, it's hot. It's a hot day. Hotter than a snake's behind, if you know what I mean. And sitting here idling, you know, riding around town, I feel very little heat on my legs. Now, a lot of motorcycles that I've owned and tested recently, the Touareg 660, my KTM 890, the Tiger 900, the Africa Twin 1100, they all have horrific engine heat. They just bake your legs, you know? I don't feel too much of that on this bike. Like, you can feel a little bit of warmth, like, kind of here behind the radiator, but, I mean, the fan's not even going. See if we can get the fan to kick on here. 202 degrees, 207. Let's see when the fan kicks on. 208. I like having that. What it doesn't give you is it doesn't tell you the temperature outside, which I found kind of interesting. Unless that's hidden somewhere that I can't find it. 210. Let's see when the fan's going to kick on here. Okay, it just turned on. It's real quiet. It turned on about 217 degrees Fahrenheit. Cooling fan is now on. It's a quiet fan. Still don't feel too much engine heat on this thing. All right, good news. It's not too windy. It's not really windy today. Usually this is a super windy spot, so I like that. Not too much wind to deal with, so pretty neutral for testing. Pulls up to 80, no problem. There's no Hayabusa, but hey, come on. Let's get in our number 2 lane here, 80 miles an hour, 82, 83. So we're at 5,000 RPM at 82 miles an hour. I'll put the kilometers here below. And I'm super impressed, guys. I gotta tell you, like, this is super comfortable at 80. Like, the wind is going mostly over my head. I'm not getting, my helmet's not being shaken around. There's no vibration from this engine to speak of. It's super smooth. It definitely doesn't have a busy, the engine doesn't feel busy like it does on like a T7, you know. This kind of reminds me more of that V-Strom 800, where it's real relaxed up at the higher speeds.
Yeah, I'm really impressed with this, and it feels real stable too. Yeah, 80 miles an hour, no problem. This thing is gonna be a great lightweight or mid-sized touring bike. If you want a touring bike and something like this, man, this is it right here. I mean, yeah, no cruise control, that really stinks, but. Another thing I noticed, you know, the mirrors are super clear. I don't have any buzz in the mirrors. Even at 85 miles an hour, I don't have any buzz in these mirrors. That's awesome. I really appreciate that. I think with a little bit bigger windshield, I'd want to jump on this bike and go cross country tomorrow. I'm ready, dude. Let's go. So smooth.
Okay, I got a bone to pick with some of you guys out there. You've said, hey, this bike is so boring. It's the most boring bike Honda's made in a long time. It's so vanilla. I'm going to use these videos to put myself to sleep at night. Push it!
Power! Lies. Lies. This motorcycle is not boring. We're talking about a bike that weighs about 450 pounds. It produces around 85 horsepower, 90 horsepower if you get the full power in Europe. It's not boring, folks. Okay, it's pretty light, it's pretty quick, it makes a nice sound, and it handles well. Hey, and it's also comfortable. I don't see how you could say this bike is boring, right? Look, I test bikes for a living, right? I get to ride everything. I would tell you if this bike is boring. It isn't. Like, I could tell you plenty of boring motorcycles that I've ridden, you know, the KLR 650, the CB500X, I could name off a bunch. Honda's own NC750, which I'm testing right now. That's kind of boring. I like the bike, super practical, but it's kind of boring. The Transalp is not that way. The Transalp has some sport to it, has some character to it, and that's something I really like about it so far. So I just don't agree. I think if you think the Transalp's boring, go ride one and really rev the thing out. I mean, hit the rev limiter like I just did. You can't just ride it at 4,000 RPM and say it's boring. Like, dude, you got to use your engine revs here. That's how the thing was designed. Okay, so we're back to the gas station right here that we got fueled up earlier. So we went over the mountain, down the mountain, did the freeway ride, and came back up. And I was not going easy on this thing, okay? I was really ringing this bike out. And we still got 56.5 miles a gallon. You can see here we've gone 58 miles. We've used 1 gallon. And so, you know, that's pretty good, you guys, because think about it, all right? 4.6 gallons, and let's assume that it's optimistic and we get 50 miles a gallon maybe, although I think it's probably accurate. That would mean that we could go over 200 miles and still have fuel left over, right? So we should have a range of around 220 miles or so if we keep getting, you know, this kind of good fuel economy here. So that's not bad. That's not bad at all. Off-road first impressions of the Transalp 750. Again, stock motorcycle, stock tires, no crash protection, nothing like that. But I want to show you how it would be to ride this bike off-road if you didn't do any modifications to it. Now, there's really only one way to start this test. And I'm sorry, little Honda, but we're just going to have to do this. I apologize, but life is hard sometimes, and you're just going to have to get used to it. All right, this gives us kind of a good view, actually, of the issue that we have. Look at the oil. Man, I wish that fan would shut off. Okay, there we go. So here's our oil sump. Yeah, God, that's such a bad design for an adventure bike that this sticks down. Imagine how much more ground clearance we'd have if this wasn't here and if this didn't stick down like this.
Man, that'd be so much better. I wish that a company would come out with an aftermarket oil pan. See, this bolts on. So we could bolt on an oil pan that was didn't have this thing that stuck out down here and a little shorter exhaust. Man, we'd be in business. So let's see how we are with the lift situation. So it's definitely impacting the side fairings there. And the handlebars dug in. I dropped it in the sand on purpose because I didn't want to actually break stuff. Hopefully, because it's a brand new bike and, you know, whatever. I paid good money for the thing. Let's go see how she is to lift. We've got plenty of good options to, I mean, it definitely falls nice and flat, that's for sure. Okay, that's really not bad. Kind of reminds me of the V-strom 800 or something. It's definitely easier than a T7 for sure. So I've got some brush shrubbery there. This did impact here. Okay, this took some impact. Fairing, it's impacted, but nothing broke. That dug in, so hand guards will be good. Overall, pretty happy with that. Not too bad. See how this thing is to balance. Camera got all wonky on me there. Hi, camera. Well, we should probably even it out, huh? Ah, okay. You know, that's why I do this in sand. It's not too bad. Bike's only going to be new for so long, folks. If an adventure bike can't deal with this, then it's not really an adventure bike, right? Because this is the reality of having an off-road bike. That's not bad to lift at all. It really isn't. Catch my breath a little bit. Whew. Okay, now let's talk about... Ooh, there's my... I modified my clutch lever. Look at that. Yeah, so that's an interesting modification. So the thing with the traction control and the ABS is super annoying that you can't, it won't remember the traction control setting or the ABS setting. So let me show you why that matters. So right now, if I have traction control engaged, here's what's gonna happen. That's full, look, that's full throttle, and I'm just not going forward. I'm not going forward, okay? Now, turn traction control off, I have to hold down mode. When I'm in user mode, I have to scroll over to that stupid thing. I have to go down, then I have to hold the thing up, and then finally, I have to hold mode again. Damn it, no, I messed it up. Now I have to do it again. Oh wait, it did hold the traction control if I switch between modes and I don't turn the key off. ABS, however, it will not do that. So now traction control's off and I can do this. Okay. You know, the bike feels actually, for these crappy stock tires, it feels really stable in the sand wash. Whoa, 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 whoa. That's some deep sand there, my friend. You don't want to get stopped in that if you don't have a knobby. All right. So other than the traction control and ABS computer thing being super annoying, other than that, I'm really impressed with the bike so far. Did we do any damage on that side? Let's see. No, just scratch that up a little bit. And we bent our lever there. That's why you need to have bark busters. Turn signal, a little scratch. Nothing else looks damaged. Shifter's okay. Mirrors got a little messed up. This motorcycle feels like half the size and weight of an Africa Twin, okay? I'm just gonna put that right up front. Now, we knew it was gonna have a pretty bouncy, pretty budget suspension, and it does. the suspension is not very good. The rear shock is like a pogo stick. It feels like it has no damping at all. Typical Honda that I've experienced lately. But that being said, if you're not planning to ride the bike fast and aggressively, I don't think it's going to be too much of a problem. And we can fix the suspension, okay? That just takes some money to address it. The things that we have that are good that we wouldn't be able to fix on some other bikes, the bike is pretty light, has a low center of gravity, it's easy and friendly to ride, and has a great engine. So the ingredients are correct. We just need to, I think, improve the suspension and, of course, do crash protection, because obviously that's not going to be good. But this bike has some serious punch, and you can definitely drift the rear tire for days if you let that engine spin. So traction control obviously is off right now. Ow. Oh, ABS, gosh darn it. Ah. Okay, that's the problem. I couldn't really stop. I mean, I was riding kind of like a jerk, but couldn't really stop with the ABS. Even in off-road mode, the ABS was still really intrusive. And the problem is, so here's how you turn off ABS, okay? You have to go hold down mode. You have to scroll over to ABS. Then you have to hold the up arrow. It says yes. Okay. Do that. Yes. Do it. Okay, why isn't it engaging? It says yes. Okay, now ABS is off. But the problem is, you stop your bike to do something, turn the bike back on, and ABS is back on. And traction control is reset. Traction control goes all the way full, and you can't drive the bike in the dirt with the traction control. It just stops. So again, I don't understand this, because BMW, KTM, a lot of brands have a system where it remembers all that when you restart the bike, and I don't understand why we're dealing with this. I just don't understand. That's one of my only complaints on an otherwise pretty fantastic motorcycle so far. Let me show you something cool with the Transalp. This is something I would never do with a lot of the heavier adventure bikes, or even like an Africa Twin. This is to do with the center of gravity and the overall feeling of weight of the bike. So like, if you look, like I can lean this thing almost all the way over and then easily lift it back up, right? It doesn't seem like it wants to like tip over, okay? Now, again, I'm not trying to be a jerk or whatever, tear up the trail. See, I just spun the bike around like that, almost like I would a dirt bike. Yeah, I'm not doing that on an Africa Twin, guys. Like, I probably could, but I'd probably drop the bike because it's so top heavy and wants to slam over. This thing is the perfect size for adventure riding. We just need to work on, you know, the ground clearance, the suspension, and maybe figure out if there's a permanent way to shut off this ABS traction control.
All right, well, now that we've drawn first blood on our new test bike here, I'm looking forward to getting home and maybe doing some tires and doing some crash bars and handguards, stuff like that. But so first impressions ride of the Transalp. Let's try to sum it up. And to do that, I want to compare it to two of Honda's existing motorcycles to try to make a point. So to try to summarize the Transalp and why I think this is such a great motorcycle and it's going to make so many people happy, I'm going to use an example of two of Honda's existing models. The CB500X, okay, I've tested that bike. A lot of you have seen my review. 47 horsepower, great little motorcycle. It's low to the ground, comfortable, easy to ride, approachable, doesn't feel heavy. You know, it's got all that going for it. But I just need more power, and I just need more suspension and a bit more ground clearance, a bit more capability, right? And some more features. Now, Honda's Africa Twin, whether you look at the 1000 or the 1100, the Adventure Sports, any of the Africa Twins, I love those bikes, I've owned them. But here's the problem. They are super heavy. They are also top heavy, and they are intimidating and somewhat challenging to ride, especially off-road when you lose your balance or if you're not a super tall person. The seats are really tall, and the bikes just feel really cumbersome and heavy, and they don't handle as well as I'd like. Here's where the Transalp comes in, right? Because it's that perfect Goldilocks of a mix between the 500X and the Africa Twin. It's a 750 engine. The weight is really nice and low, 455 pounds. The balance, the center of gravity is really nice and low. It feels like a CB500X with double the power, because basically it is. Yeah, the suspension is kind of budget, but we can address that. Yes, the ground clearance is a concern, but we're going to do a skid plate. We'll see how the ground clearance plays out. And let's be honest, guys, is a lack of ground clearance really what's holding you back in your off-road riding, or is it your skill and confidence and your ability? I think it's probably the second thing, right? So let's be honest about that. So let's start to, episode 3 will be a full in-depth technical breakdown of the bike, maintenance, ownership, all that kind of stuff. Then we're going to start doing some other testing with it and do some mods and really see, you know, how capable this thing is, because I have another bone to pick with you guys. A lot of you have said, oh, this bike's not going to be ever as good as a T7 off-road. I don't agree with that at all. I think that's complete hogwash. The only thing is, yeah, we're going to need to upgrade the suspension a little bit, especially like springs and stuff, and put a good bash plate on it. I mean, the fact that it has like 1 inch less ground clearance than a T7, or maybe 1.5 inches, does that really matter? Is that really what's going to be your limit? This bike feels lighter and it has a lower center of gravity and is easier to pick up than a T7. And the engine has more power and it has a better LCD and it costs less than a T7. And it has more gas, a bigger gas tank. So you see what I'm saying? Like, this thing is pretty awesome and it has the potential to be a bit of a unicorn. It's not perfect and it's never going to be perfect, but I think with a few changes, this thing is going to be a killer, killer bike. And it's even going to keep, you know, more experienced, more spoiled rider like myself engaged and entertained. So thanks so much for watching. Please stay tuned for the rest of the series. It's going to be awesome. Thanks for being on board. Ride safe and I'll see you out there.